Bolinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of The Reward, written by Peter Corris and read by Peter Hosking. Thanks to Paul Abraham, Jean Bedford, Rebecca Donaldson, Sophia Gollan, Tom Kelly, Tanya Sourdin. Chapter 1. Do you remember Ramona Beckett, Hardy? I remember her, I said. Perhaps you also remember that her family offered a reward for information leading to the arrest and conviction of whoever was responsible for her death. This was about 2 years after she disappeared, and that's 15 fucking years ago. I shrugged. If you say so. Am I right in thinking that you had something to do with her? The man who asked the question was Barry White, an ex-cop, ex-private detective, ex-nightclub bouncer, ex just about anything in that line you could think of. He was middle class, university educated, and had made detective sergeant pretty quickly. But he'd resigned from the force just ahead of a corruption charge. Like me, he'd lost his PEA license for breaches of the regulations. I'd regained mine fairly easily and quickly on the basis of a previously good record and the recommendations of police officers and others whose integrity was unquestioned at a time when a lot of questioning was going on. White hadn't been so lucky. The only cops he knew were as corrupt as he was and were leaving the force under clouds or to go behind bars. He was a big, strong man, or had been, and he'd looked pretty formidable outside a nightclub for a while. But the booze softened and slowed him, and people who like to start trouble in those places these days have learned martial arts tricks that could make an old thumper like Barry look silly. Me too, for that matter. So he'd slipped down a few more notches. When he turned up at my office that Monday morning, I thought he might be scrounging for work. He wasn't. I knew her, yes. Ramona was a rich, spoiled young woman who wanted to be the first female Premier of New South Wales. She did a sociology degree at Sydney, and after blooding herself in university politics and local government, she decided that blackmail was the way to go. She set about seducing politicians and influential people with the aim of getting leverage on them to put her where she wanted to be in politics. One of her victims had had the guts to come to me professionally, and I'd helped him. Yeah, we'll get to that. The unusual thing about this reward, White said, is that the money was well invested and has accrued interest. The amount on offer now stands at over $1 million. I didn't know that. It's a long time ago. People forget. But no one was ever charged with Beckett's murder, and the reward is still available, although her father's dead now. You might remember that her mother was much younger. Mrs. Beckett is still very much alive, and at last report was still keen to see justice done. I didn't like the smell of this. It's nearly 17 years ago, Barry, I said. Sure, I was around when it all happened. Where were you? He grinned. And as it changed expression, the high-coloured face showed the marks of booze and fists and late nights. He wouldn't have been much over 40, and he looked 60. He took out a packet of drum tobacco and probed in it for the papers. You mind? I said I didn't, but I did. A bit. I used to roll them myself, and I still missed the taste of the tobacco. Especially the first three or four smokes on a clean pellet. But I didn't miss the cough and the short wind. Still, the smell was good, and there was no law against me enjoying that. He rolled the smoke expertly and lit it with a match, which he put in his jacket pocket. He wore a business shirt, not too clean, a tie, likewise, a double-breasted blazer with one gold button missing, grey trousers and black shoes that had just had a shine. He sported a fresh haircut and shave, and I could smell the lotions. I hadn't seen him for a while, but what I'd heard of him was that his marriage was washed up and that he was living in a room in Chippendale. Clearly he'd spruced himself up to see me. I was suspicious rather than flattered. He blew smoke towards the window where a little more grime wouldn't hurt. I had the office painted and the windows cleaned a year ago when I was given a 2-year lease. It looked all right for a while, but somehow lately it had slipped back. I was there too, White said. I was a probationary D at the loo. What's this about, Barry? Fuck, what do you think? It's about the money, of course. I've got a line on who knocked Beckett. Oh, yeah? And who was that? He laughed through an exhalation of smoke, and the cough caught him like a hard right to the ribs. He doubled over, and his face turned purple as he fought the spasm. Jesus, Barry, I said, you're holding a full hand for a heart attack. Oh, no, he gasped, fighting for breath. When he finally sucked some air in, he said, "I'm just about fucked if I don't get this money. I've got high blood pressure, a touch of emphysema and a crooked liver. They reckon I can pull out of it if I stop drinking and smoking, lose weight and eat lettuce. If I can get the money, I'll do it. I'll go to one of those health farms in the fucking Blue Mountains and drink mineral water and be a good boy. It'll be worth it. Kicking shit the way I am now, I'd just as soon be out at Rookwood." I nodded. I could understand that. It's easy to eat healthily if you can afford asparagus and chicken fillets. A good bottle of wine won't do the damage of a slab of beer. Trouble was, that line of thought made me feel like a drink, and it was only 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 hours before my self-imposed starting time. He went into a coughing fit again, and while I waited for him to recover, I tried to remember what dealings I'd had with him before. There wasn't much. A bit of a brush when he was extorting from a madam named Ruby Thompson, who was a friend, and I asked him to lay off. He got even by verbaling a client of mine who was probably guilty anyway, but deserved a second chance. He got his breath back and looked at the cigarette he'd put in the ashtray. He reached over and snuffed it out. Maybe he could rehabilitate himself after all. Okay, I'd forgotten your sense of humour. Try not to make me laugh, Hardy. I could drop dead on you. I was thinking he could drop dead for all I cared, but I knew that wasn't quite true. I had ambivalent feelings about Ramona Beckett, but my feelings about $1 million were pretty straightforward. The way I heard it, you screwed her, literally and otherwise. No comment. Come on, Hardy, I'm lining up $100,000 fucking dollars for you. I need to know how close you got to her. While I didn't have White's health problems, things weren't getting easier. I was pushing 50 and the private detective business, like everything else, was rapidly being taken over by computers. Process serving was being done by email and fax. Money was moved electronically rather than in briefcases. And there were big agencies specialising in finding lost kids, debugging officers, and protecting men in suits. I didn't have any life insurance, and the superannuation the government was obliging me to pay myself wouldn't keep me in red wine and second-hand books if I stopped earning. I had to be interested in $100,000. There were a lot of questions in my head, but it was best to play along for now. You knew what her line was, did you? Not really. Tell me. I told him. This bloke she was blackmailing came to me for help, and we set her up. Sort of bite-a-bit thing. I pretended to be a bigwig, a lawyer who controlled the pre-selection for a safe Liberal seat. She arranged her usual deal, the drinks, the fuck in her pot's point flat, the video camera. Only she was a solo operator by necessity and couldn't keep a finger on everything. I had help. I had someone swipe the video and substitute another one. I taped her when she came to me with a pitch. Then I turned the tables on her. Told her I'd send the video to her dad and give the tape to the cops and the papers. She backed off after that, but she might have done it again. Just being more careful. I don't know. She went missing, about a year after that, maybe less. White nodded. I get it. I tried to tell it matter-of-factly, but it hadn't been like that at all. Ramona Beckett was hell on wheels. Tall, dark, thin, with sexual energy in every gesture. She ate like a wharfie and was a junior gymnastics champion who ran 15 kilometres every day. She had a fast metabolism, but her touch was strangely cold. She got by on 5 or 6 hours sleep. She read a lot of books and liked to wear black leather, the way she had the night I turned the tables on her. She was a living, breathing contradiction. A feminist, a reactionary, a corrupter, and an idealist. She genuinely believed that she could improve life in the state for everyone if only she could acquire the power to do it. She ended up hating me, of course, but I couldn't say I had the same feeling for her. I got a tissue from a pocket pack in the desk drawer and blew my nose. Clear the sinuses and you can clear a lot more besides. Any number of people could have had reason to kill her, I said. Including the guy you worked for? I shrugged. Who knows? Maybe. Maybe he didn't tell me the whole story, but he's definitely not a candidate to bring in the reward on because he's dead. Out came the tobacco again, and the brown-stained fingers rolled the cigarette just as deftly as before. He looked at it, burred over the ends, smoothed out the wrinkles, tapped it on his thumbnail and didn't light it. Better not, he said. You might make me laugh again. I'll try not to. Why don't you try not beating about the bush? You said you had a line. White leaned forward across the desk. His teeth were bad and his breath was worse. He was sweating too, and there was a stale odour coming from his clothes. The word is it was a kidnapping. There was a ransom note that got suppressed. Chapter 2. Well, that got my attention. Until very recently, there were any number of cops and lawyers and magistrates and politicians in Sydney who acted as if none of the laws applied to them. 17 years ago, it was even worse. "That's interesting, Barry," I said. "Tell me more." He eased back in his chair. "Are you in?" "Oh, come on, I'd have to know a lot more than that. And in for what? You said 100 grand? "That's right. 10%. That's generous. I'd have to split the reward with at least 3 other people." "Who?" He shook his head. "I need a commitment. And I get a $500 retainer and $200 a day plus expenses." "Do I look like I got that sort of money?" "You'll have to work on a contingency basis." It's a natural reaction to place some confidence in a person with a decent vocabulary and a reasonable command of grammar, but in Barry White's case, the impulse had to be fought against. As I say, he was well educated and no one ever called him dumb, but he was corrupt and devious, or had been, and I'd never known adversity to straighten anyone out. "I don't think so, Barry, no." He gave that grin again, which must have been appealing when he was in better condition. He squirmed bulkily in the chair and took a thin wallet from his hip pocket. "That was worth a try, Hardy." He took 7 $100 notes from the wallet and laid them on the desk. "This buys me one day, right? The retainer's returnable if you back out." His eyes were faintly bloodshot and it clearly hurt him to part with the money. That he was doing it meant something, but what? "That's right. If I take you on. You're not a good bet, Barry. You verbaled blokes and planted drugs on women and took kickbacks till you forgot what job you were supposed to be doing." "All that's true," he said. "I was a fucking idiot. I thought I was too smart to get caught. Do you know what I did with all that money? I drank and ate and fucked it away. That's how dumb I was. I've got nothing, Hardy. No wife, no kids, no house, no reputation, no pride. All I've got is this one chance." "Have you ever been down to one chance?" "Not quite, but close." I thought about how it had been when Sin left me, coldly removing every single item she'd owned and breaking a lot of those we'd owned jointly. I thought about the alcoholic slide I'd gone into when Glenn Withers married her policeman, and the nice structured life I'd had had fallen apart like a house of cards, and it was my fault. Pretty close. His eyes darted around the room, taking in the dirty windows, the dust on the fax machine at the top of the filing cabinet, the peanut shells in the waste paper basket. "You're not exactly setting the world on fire yourself, are you?" If we'd been in a boxing ring, you'd have to have called the round about even. I was tired of sparring. I knew I wanted a crack at the 100 grand. I just didn't want to do it completely on his terms. "Why do you need me, Barry? You were a cop and a PEA. You know the ropes. You've got some information, some contacts, some leads. You know how to talk to people. Why are you here?" If he knew he had me, he didn't show it. He finally brought the rolly up to his mouth and lit it, again putting the match in his pocket. It made me wonder if he'd been inside, where they do little things like saving matches to play cards with. He drew on the smoke judiciously. "I haven't got the resources," he said. "I haven't got a car or a mobile or an answering machine. I haven't got any decent clothes, and most of all, I haven't got the contacts. This is going to mean talking to cops and lawyers and journos. You can do it. I can't. There's a few things we can do together, but not much. That's why I need someone. I'm not going to piss in your pocket, Hardy, but I know you don't rip people off. That's why I need you. What do you say?" "The lawyers are all doing it, so why not the PEAs?" I negotiated a contract with Barry White on a contingency basis. I was to get 10% of whatever reward money he recovered, my cut to come off the top. How he divided up the remainder was his business. I had the option to work on other matters simultaneously and to pull out of the arrangement at any time after the first week. This meant I was giving him 6 days' credit. Give a little, take a little. He signed with a flourish. "Shit, I need a drink," he said. "I'll shout you one in a minute. First things first, where does the information about the ransom note come from?" White had finished his cigarette without choking, and he made another one.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.